Jesus, work in the rain. Spreading the gospel, we'll never complain. Though the days may grow long, we'll strive harder to be all the cowboys for Jesus should be. On the wide open prairie, through the day and the night, we'll carry the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ. Like the clear stars in heaven, or the desert so bright, we'll have a roundup with the gospel of light.
God's love surround you, may you find a brighter day. May he grant you the peace you seek in every way. God's light burns in each life, yours and mine. And you can be a beacon if you'll just let him shine. Come on, y'all, sing it. Oh, you can be a beacon if you'll let him shine. You can be a beacon if you'll let him shine. Jesus is lighting all the world by God's feet. You can be a beacon if you'll let him shine. You can be a beacon if you'll let him shine. You can be a beacon if you'll let him shine. Jesus is the light in all the world by God's design. And we can be a beacon if we'll let him shine. You can be a beacon if you'll let him shine. That was just a trial run, but we're going to get it right. You know, God is so good, and these people know how to play, and they know I don't know any music, but they're doing a really good job to keep up with me. But you know what? Satan's going to fight it. He already is, but God's so good. He's bigger than Satan. He's bigger than all we face, and he loves us, and we can't lose. And you know what? The question of the day is still, are you washed in the blood? Because if you're washed in the blood, you're victory. No matter what you go through, we are more than victorious through Jesus Christ. So I claim the blood, and I am washed in the blood, and that's what we're going to sing, and if you know it, sing it with us. Come on, y'all. Help us out. Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in his grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Ask somebody, are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Come on, y'all, sing. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Well, are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? This is Miss Carolyn. Don't she do a good job? And this is Cole, and he's an added blessing, a young blessing to our training. And this is Cole's dad. His name is Chris. I forgot their last names, but y'all just stick with the first name. We'll be safe there. And right here we have Miss Linda. How many of y'all love a beautiful lady standing here? And this is Mr. Vernon Racer. Most of you know him. He not only preaches, he sings, he plays everything under the sun. But we're glad that he helped us put this together. And this is Mr. Ed Jones, is that right? And he just joined us, but he's doing a great job. Y'all give them all a hand. Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Come on, y'all, sing it loud. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Well, are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Thank you, Jesus.
It'll take us a little while to get all them sounds squealed together and let them blend together, but I think it's going to sound pretty good. I really do. Y'all will get to see them here in a little while. Folks, we got buckets at each and every one of these doors. That's for your tithe and your offerings and your donations. That lets us pay the bills we need to pay and help folks out, and we appreciate that. Men's Bible study, right up there, 7 o'clock on Tuesday mornings. We got a real good teacher, a real good subject, and got pretty good crowd of men coming. So if you guys want to come at 7 o'clock on a Tuesday morning, you're more than welcome. We want to thank the Mason family for allowing us to use these facilities. Pretty nice in here, isn't it? Be honest, I've been in churches that didn't have this nice of seats. But you know what? The Lord was still there. Amen? That's what counts. As long as the Lord's here. Upcoming singers. Let's see. Who we got here? Okay. Next week, Spreading the Word Quartet. That's January 25th. February the 1st. Now, this one's kind of an interesting one. I don't know that I've heard them. They're called the Singing Bones. I don't know whether that means they're skinny. Singing Bones. Or whether they play bone sticks. Or I don't know how that works out. No, I understand they're really a good group. And so they'll be here next February the 1st. David Shaw will be here February the 8th. This new band will be here February the 15th. Homer Belter will be here on February the 22nd. So we're going to have a good time, and I know we will, and I thank y'all for supporting it and coming out. Prayer request. Oh, got a lot of prayer requests. I guess we'll start with Sharon. She's down in the hospital in the city. So they found the blood leaks. They figured out where they're at finally. But the hospital that she's in, the only hospital she could get in at the time, they, if I remember right, they cauterize these things. And if the walls are so thin, they're afraid if they cauterize it, then it's going to have a bigger hole. So she's got a problem there. She's trying to get over to another hospital who does, they're a little more extensive in the way they can fix it. But she needs your prayer. She's having a hard time of it. The whole family's having a hard time of it. But keep them in your prayer. They're still looking at other hospitals, even out of state now, to try to find somebody that can do that. But remember this. Wasn't just, 2 weeks ago? She had to have a 3 bypass. All the doctors was refusing to do it. Said, no, if we do it, she's not going to survive it. Had this one old doctor in there. He says, you know, I think I can do that. You know what? He went in there and he didn't even have to do the bypasses. He put a stent in the main artery. That stent in the main artery moved her blood flow from 10% to 100%, just like that. So by doing that, yeah. By doing that, it blew out 2 arteries on the 2 other main arteries. So he ended up putting 5 stents, but you know what? It fixed her blood flow. But when it fixed her blood flow, then it caused the pressure on the veins to start leaking again. So it's kind of a catch-22, but there's one doctor over at the Baptist, wasn't it, that says he can do it, but you can't get in the hospital. Hospitals are full down there. I mean full. Nobody, they're not taking people hardly at all. And until they get an opening to get her over there. Anyway, she needs your prayers. She really needs your prayers. They have really been through it over the last few months. And I know God's still on the throne, and God's still in charge. And I do believe that he's gonna send her somebody or send her somewhere that somebody says, I can fix that. And they're gonna fix that just like they did with the heart. So keep her in your prayers. Our next biggest one is Caleb. Caleb is not good. They've sent him home. He's got a hospice now, right? And I don't know how long he may stay. He may stay a couple of months or so. I've got this here. I always pray for Caleb. The tumor has almost filled his right lung already. He has had trouble breathing and is having trouble eating. What we want to do is claim complete and total healing in Jesus' name. You know, when I was over there praying with Caleb, Rose and I went over there. Like I told Caleb, you know, you got man's opinion. Man can only see certain things. He can see what he sees. God's still on the throne. He's the one still in charge. And he can heal him. And that's what I want you to pray. That he will completely and totally heal Caleb. Take all that cancer out of his lungs. Take that lung and just clear it completely up. Campaign has been started by a friend of the family to send Hot Wheels. You know the little Hot Wheels? Y'all ever played with them little Hot Wheels? Now, come on now. Y'all ain't that old. Them Hot Wheels been around a while, ain't they? The car campaigned for a Hot Wheel with an uplifting or a healing Bible verse attached to it. In other words, attach a Bible verse or an uplifting verse or an uplifting word along with who it's from. And I got this address here. Send it. Y'all probably ain't going to remember it, so I'll have somebody put it out. 3601 East Roop. 3601 East Roop. That means it's on the east side of town. Enid, Oklahoma, 73701. You can mail it or you can take it, however you want to get it there. Probably mail it would be the easiest for the family. But y'all keep that in your prayer. That's a really, really, really important prayer request. I have not had a chance to see Mary this week. I don't know how she's doing. Does anybody know how Mary's doing? Yeah. Okay. We'll need to. You do? Okay. Tell us when we get around to you, okay? Terry and Pat Woods, pray for our country and our leaders. Don't ever forget to pray for our country and our leaders. We are in dire trouble in this country. And I got a request. David Money. Anybody know David Money? He's been around here for a long time. He doesn't come here very often. But I see him at restaurants here and there. And he's adopted me as his pastor, I guess, I believe, because he calls me a lot. But anyway, he's in the hospital now. And we were up there visiting him today. His lungs just did not sound good. And we were standing there when the doctor came in. He says, well, I don't know whether that's fluid from cancer or whether it's something else. But he's in sad shape. Pray for him if you know him. He's a good guy. He likes to talk. He's real friendly. And, you know, that just seems to be going around a lot, that cancer stuff. I'd just like to see the Lord just take that stuff plumb out of here and just remove it from the earth. But right now we've got it. We've got to deal with it. But pray for David Money, if you will. He's a little feller. He's not real big, but he's a good guy. He's friendly. God loves him. We love him. Just keep him in your prayers. All right. How about right over here? Prayer requests, praise reports, birthdays, anniversaries, something we need to know.
I would like to ask prayer for my sister, Mary Beth Baker. She had a slight stroke today, and I think she's doing okay, but they're going to run some tests on her tomorrow, and they'll probably keep her through Saturday. So if you'd just ask prayer for her, I'd appreciate it. Thanks.
Like prayer for Marcy McGar. She used to sit, always sat right down here. She fell and broke her hip. She's up in the fifth floor of St. Mary's.
Pray for my nephew, Terry Caldwell. He was in that explosion in Enid almost a month ago. And they're thinking about pulling the plug on him now. So he needs some prayers.
Amen. Pardon request. Anybody else in this section? Right there. Jesse.
Yes, Sharon's daughter, Kathy, she has an infected sinus, so she's been pretty sick too.
Amen. All right. How about over here? Anybody? Right up top.
Yeah, Terry, I just wanted to thank everybody for praying for Veda when she had her cancer out of her hand.
Yeah.
She had it the week ago last Monday, and everything is healing real good. The stitches will dissolve on their own, so I'll have to have those removed. So everything is good. Thank you.
Amen. Anybody else in this section? Right there.
Rain. We need rain really
bad. That's the truth. We do need rain.
I want to thank everybody for the prayers and the calls from my sister while she was in the process of fighting this old cancer. Thank you.
My nephew has got to go home to stay with my sister, and he's eating better. He's getting home-cooked food. And
there you go.
So he's beginning to get some strength back, but he still has a long road ahead of him.
January the 7th, we've been married 69 years.
How long?
69.
Well, I could tell that on you, brother, but you don't look that old.
Most gracious Heavenly Father, we just, sometimes we don't know what words to use to pray. There's a lot of serious requests here tonight, Lord. But Lord, you know what needs to be said. You know what's in our hearts, what's in our minds. We just lift up Caleb. We lift up the family too, Lord. Lord, we just lift up all the requests here tonight. We just pray for that anointing to be upon the band, to be upon Rosie, to be upon Terry tonight as he brings us your word, Lord. Let those words, let the songs empower us, lift us up. Lord, let us walk down that path as we leave here tonight to that world outside, a lost and dying world. Let us be that light. Let us reflect the hope that's within us. These things I pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Aren't you glad God's in control all the time? And sometimes we just don't feel like we have a chance or don't have any control, but we don't. If we give it to Him, He can handle it. At His word, He speaks, and it'll be done. And He has the best plan for each one of us. And all we have to do is just hold on. Help's on the way. And it really is. Could be tonight that very present help is going to come take us all out. And that's the way I want to go. I want to go everybody together. I always like the crowd. But God's good, and help is on the way. Don't give up. Just look up. He's praying for you. Woman in the Bible days, her last meal almost gone. But God sent Elijah to make His word known. He said, woman, don't you worry, God sent me today. And before you help was on the way. So just hold on a little longer. Help is on the way. A brighter day is coming for those who believe and pray. Help won't help tomorrow if you give up today. So just hold on a little longer.
Help is on the way.
You know, the Bible says he's a very present help in time of trouble. He's right there in the good times and the bad. And he loves you the same all the way through. We can't lose, because we're winners. In Jesus, we're always going to be a winner. Troubles of this life come by, and burdens get you down. You think no one is listening, you think no one's around. Just remember what his word says. Trust him and obey. Keep your eyes toward the heavens, 'cause help is on the way. So just hold on a little longer. Help is on the way. A brighter day is coming for those who believe and pray. Help won't help tomorrow if you give up today. So just hold on a little longer. Help is on the way. No help won't help tomorrow if you give up today. So just hold on a little longer, 'cause help is on the way. Thank you, Jesus. We love you and we trust you. We know you know best.
Aren't y'all glad I told her to sing? Woo. That's not quite the way it worked out, but I did help her some. I mean, I encouraged her. How's that? No, she's had the privilege of singing all over this country. That's an honor. We'll be in the Luke chapter 5 tonight, if you have your Bibles. And we're going to begin reading in verse number 1. And it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God. Whew, how long has it been since you've seen that? People pressed upon him to hear the word of God. He stood by the lake of Gennesaret. I cannot get that right. It's got an E in the wrong place. I keep looking at it and say, that's wrong. But this is the Bible. It's not wrong. And saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen were gone out of them and were washing their nets. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he should thirst out a little from the land. And he sat down and he taught the people out of the ship. And when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a draught. And Simon answered and said unto him, Master, we've toiled all night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, listen to this. This is where we're supposed to be. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down my net. That's what you call obedience. When Christ asks you to do something, that's called obedience when you do it. Don't you wish that folks were still that hungry for the word of the Lord here in the year of 2018 now? It is 18, isn't it? 2018, brand new year. But up here it said, as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God. We don't see that happening a whole lot anymore. It'd be kind of like going out and feeding the chickens. Y'all ever raise chickens? I was a kid. That was my job, is feed the chickens. You'd go out there going along, here, chick, 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 chick. You chunk that feed out, right? And all of a sudden, here they come, just a whole flock of them, just jumping out there on the ground. They just come a running. Wouldn't that be nice if people would come to church that way? Yeah? Here, Christian, you know? And here they come, just flocking in. That's what the old chickens used to do, I know. Verse number 1 tells us that the people pressed upon Jesus to hear the word of the Lord as he spake unto them. Wouldn't it be great as when preacher got in a pulpit and he opened this Bible. He ruffled them pages. Can you hear the pages ruffled? You hear a Bible that's ruffled in pages. Wouldn't it be great if the people would just come hungry? Let me hear it. Let me hear the rustle of them pages. That's what we're talking about. Jesus set an example for all of us. The Word of God is not, listen to me, the Word of God is not something we hide. Amen? It is something that we are to spread. We're to talk it. We're to preach it. We're to give it to other folks. We are to preach it, walk it, live it. And we walk it in authority. The authority of Jesus Christ gave us to spread the Word. That's what He's asked us to do. Who better to speak with authority than the source itself? Jesus Christ. And when He spoke, the demons, listen, what, when He spoke, the demons had to obey. Can you imagine? The Bible tells us that He was sent to this world to heal the sick and the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recover sight to the blind, not only physical blindness, but what? Also spiritual blindness. And there's a lot of that around. Not by might can this be done, not by power can this be done, but what is it? By My Spirit, saith the Lord. Only His Word, obedience to His Word, that is what invites the Spirit to actually take control. We are just the vessel. We are just the vessel. When we pray for somebody, we're just the vessel that He uses, just like His mother, Mary, was the vessel that He used. Total obedience, trust, and obey, for there is no other way. Luke chapter 1, verse number 38, and Mary said, "Behold, the handmaiden of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word." Folks, that is obedience. When we obey what Christ has taught us to do and ask us to do, we are in obedience. She trusted the very word that she would carry and deliver. She carried the word of God, Jesus Christ, the Savior of a lost and dying world, the world that Jesus hung on a cross, brutally killed Him because what? They didn't want to hear the truth. Same thing that's going on nowadays. They don't want to hear the truth. They don't want somebody to tell them they're doing something wrong. Some things never change. Nobody wants to hear the truth. Still there. Back to our text, verse number 2. It says, "And saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen were gone out of them and were washing their nets." See, they didn't have a good day of fishing. Anybody ever been there? I'm there every time I go fishing. I just can't ever seem to catch them. And when I do, they're about that long. You have to chunk them back or use them for bait. But they were out washing their nets. They said, "Okay, it's a call of the day. We haven't caught anything. Let's wash our nets out." But you know what happened? Jesus came aboard all of a sudden. Makes a difference, doesn't it? It always makes a difference when the master fisherman comes aboard. After all, who knows where the best fish are? The man that put them there. Amen? He put them out there. He knows they're out there. That would be the guy I'd turn to. But this visit was not talking about fishing fish. This is talking about another fishing. Verse number 3 says, "And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed that he would thrust out a little from the land." That's where we were talking about a while ago. "And he sat down and taught the people out of the ship." See, Jesus had an appointment. Jesus makes appointments. You say, "Well, he had never made an appointment with me." I bet he has. You may not have recognized it. Jesus makes an appointment with an old burly fisherman out there named Simon. Probably, from what I understand, he was kind of big and burly and just looked like probably was pretty rough. He knew how to catch fish. He thought he did anyway. He didn't catch any that night. But he did not know Jesus. Oh, there's a lot of people like that. They know the name. They've heard it somewhere. Where do I hear that? Jesus asked Simon to move the ship out a little bit from the land so that he continued preaching to the people. After Simon moved the ship out, Jesus asked him to, he sat down on the ship and taught the people. All that time, Jesus was teaching the people. Guess what? The big fish that he was really wanting that night was sitting right there with him listening. That was what Jesus caught that night. That was Simon. You know, when we do things for the Lord, work for the Lord, preaching, singing, witnessing, whatever we do for the Lord, well, there's a lot of things we can do for the Lord. Be a help to your neighbors is being a witness about the Lord. We may never know who the real target is or who the real fish is that the Lord is using us to help reel in. But somebody is watching. Somebody's watching what you do. Somebody's watching what you say. That may be the very person that the Lord is trying to save. We don't want to keep him from doing that. Now, what we do know is that the word will not ever return void. It's impossible for the word to return void. It will accomplish its purpose. If we will obey and speak the word, y'all are being quiet with me. In other words, shoot that arrow at whatever target you're shooting it at. God can make it hit the right target, and his word will not return void. That's why we speak it. Isaiah 55:11 says, "So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it." Then in verse number 4 of our text says, "And now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a draught." Now what had already happened? They'd already quit fishing, right? They'd already cleaned up the nets. I mean, they were through for the night. What did Jesus tell them? Go out in the deep, throw your nets out there. Now Simon, as you know, he's pretty speakable. I mean, he speaks pretty good. He likes to talk. He's pretty jolly. And you know he's going to be the one that becomes the Apostle Peter. That's God's plan for him. God sent the word. Jesus Christ is fulfilling this plan right now. Peter was one of the target fish to be caught. Launch out into the deep and let your nets down for a draught was what Jesus told him. Listen to verse number 5. And Simon answered unto him, saying, "Master, we've toiled all night already. We've been out there all night long, and we have nothing, have absolutely nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let the net down." Folks, that's obedience. "Peter, do what I ask you to do." Peter said, "Nevertheless, at thy word, I'll do that." You think Peter didn't know who Christ was? Can't you just hear Peter telling Jesus, "I've already been there, already done that"? How many times we say that? "I've already been there, already done that. There ain't nothing out there." And when I'm fishing, I say that a lot. But somebody will come up with a bunch of fish and say, "No, you're wrong." But he said, "Lord, we're tired. We've already washed our nets out. We've got them all folded up." He was through for the day. But Peter did not realize that God knew where all the fish were. Do you realize that there's absolutely nothing God doesn't know? There is absolutely nothing God doesn't know. You may think you hid something. Guess what? You didn't hide nothing. God knows where it's at. And guess what? He may show somebody else where it's at. So you got to be cautious about hiding things. Amen? Bible says that God knows where everything is. Peter did not realize that God knew where all the fish was. But you know what? God was fixing to use Peter. Peter didn't know it just yet, but he was fixing to find that out. Now listen there. This is what I've heard so many times. But God. Now how many times have you said that? But God, I can't do that. He asked something simple. I could honestly not tell you how many times I said, but God, I can't do that. That's not me. You know what? If he called you to do it, that's you. Amen. If he called you to do it, that's you. That means that's what he wants you to do. And you say, "But God, I can't do that." He said, "Yeah, you can." Now, Peter was respectful, but he was also tired. He'd had a hard day. Well, just like we get tired. Tired of people being, oh, yes. I wrote this down because it's so true. I'm tired of people being sick. They get over it. 3 days later, they're back sick again. Same thing. You know what? That's the devil. That ain't the Lord. That's the devil. He's the one doing that. And it just makes you frustrated when you see somebody get back on their feet and all of a sudden the next day they're back down on a hard time. Up one day, then down the next. You know what we do? We just whine because we have to go pray for them or probably have to go encourage them. Y'all looking at me like you don't believe that, but it's true. Every one of us do that. Well, Lord, I don't have time to do it right now, but I'll do it, what, later? Is that an excuse? Sounds like it to me. Well, let me tell you this. Yes, we do speak the word of the Lord, and we pray for people. Why? Because they need it. And God needs for us to obey him and do what he's told us to do. We aren't the one doing the miracle. That's God's job. That's his job. We're the ones to ask him to do that. Ours is to obey and trust him. There really is a method to what seems like only madness at times. You know what it is? It's the message. It's the word. Jesus Christ and the word made flesh dwelt among us. He can do anything he wants to do. Why? Because he's God. Now, if we don't ask him to do what we need him to do, who's at fault? If I was guilty, I'd be silent too. It's us. We need to ask him for what we need. That's what he's there for. In Matthew chapter 16, verse 18, Jesus said, "And I say also unto thee, thou art Peter." Now he's talking to Peter. "And upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." Now, folks, if you think about that, think about what Christ said. "I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it." Now, that's not just a little bitty picture of something or a little fishing hole. That is the whole wide world that he sent him out into. "Peter, upon this rock, I'm going to build my church." God had a plan for that day, for the catch, and one while he caught him, he caught. They caught so many fish, both ships began to sink. "Chunk out the fish. We caught too many, boys." And that all day long, all into the night, they had not caught a fish. Verse number 8 says, "When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, 'Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord.'" We can all say that. But you don't want him to leave. You want him to stay. You want him to clean you up. Peter was the catch of the day that day. He was sent out to preach the gospel, to open the eyes of the blind. Every time the word goes forth, folks, somebody has a blessing. You may never know who it is, but somebody has a blessing. At the word of Jesus, Peter obeyed, and the answer, the rock of the church was born. Luke 5:10. "And Jesus said unto Simon, 'Fear not, from hence thou shalt catch men.'" Why? Because he obeyed Christ. He's going to draw men to him. Jesus had a plan. He lived the word. He walked on this earth. He preached the word. Just like we're doing right now. Preaching the word, trying to draw one more soul in. Verse number 11 says, "And when they had brought their ships to land, they forsook them and followed him." We don't need them ships. We can't get nothing out of them. We're going to follow Christ. What Jesus was doing was birthing the church. He was birthing the church that he was fixing to have to die for. He birthed it. He built it. And he died for it. He died for us. No matter what others may say, God always, always has the last say. I know I've always heard that women always had the last say. But I'm going to tell you, that's wrong. God has the last say. Always has. And that was a joke. My wife knows what that one means. Women always have the last say. But sometimes they need to have the last say. Saying's not doing. See, that's the whole key to that one. Yeah, I'll leave that one alone. Revelation chapter 22, verse 17 says, "And the Spirit and the bride say, Come, and let him that heareth say, Come, and let him that athirst come, and whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely." Romans 8, 1 says, "There is therefore no condemnation, no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus." Are they still going to make mistakes? Of course you are. We're human. As long as we're human, we're going to make mistakes. "Who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit." My question to you tonight is, have you done that? Have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior? If you haven't, guess what? You can. He's willing to set you on this cold night right here. If you have not accepted Christ, you need to. Romans 10, 13 says, "For whosoever shall what? Call upon the name of the Lord, shall what? Be saved." People say it can't be that simple. Yes, it is. That's the Bible. Yes, it is. That's God's Word. Now, that is a promise right out of God's Word. Jesus loves you, and He wants you to come live with Him forever. I love you, and I would like to talk to you, but I don't want you to live with me here. Maybe forever somewhere else. Amen? I like all of you, but we can't feed everybody. No, I was joking. If you do not know Christ as your Savior, it's a fun experience. People say, "Well, you know, I just can't do that." Why? What are you going to do if you die tonight? You're going to go to hell. I'll tell you where you're going. The Bible very clearly teaches that. You're safe in Christ. Without Christ, you're not safe. If you're not saved, don't leave this building. I'll be out here walking around listening to the band that's fixing to play again. And just stop me and say, "Hey, preacher, I'd like to talk to you." You know why? Because I'd love to talk to you. If you're here and not saved, you need to get saved before you leave this building. We're not guaranteed to strip out onto the highway. Don't take that risk. God loves you. He got old Peter, and Peter didn't know what was going on at the time, but you know what? God said He built his church on him. It's a powerful, powerful, powerful thing to come to know the Lord. You'll never regret it. Are y'all ready to sing? All right, here in just a minute. All right. Like I said, if you're not saved, see me up here somewhere. I'll be wandering around. Let's pray. Father, we do thank You for Your Word. You've told us it will not return void. Father, we've shared Your Word. If anybody in this building is not saved, that You'll just draw them tonight and let them come to know You. For that, Lord, they'll never, ever find anything better than You. They'll never, ever have in their life have anything better than You. Father, we just ask You to draw them, let them come to know You. And Father, I ask You to bless this band as they sing. Just bless us as we continue this service. In Jesus' precious name we ask. Amen. Okay. This new band, y'all give them a hand. I think they're doing pretty good.
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. Oh, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life have grown, I'll fly away. Like a bird from prison bars that's flown, I'll fly away. Oh, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. Let me be ready to go. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. This is Cole. He brings youth to us.
Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away.
Y'all do this.
To a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away.
You may take off.
Oh, I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away.
Watch David, he's got it.
When I die, hallelujah, I'm bound. I'll fly away.
They have to keep up with me because I don't know when to stop. Man, I just keep going.
We'll figure out how to just stop again here in a little bit.
I'm gonna have to put a rope around my waist and he'll just go do this. But God is good and we're learning and they're easy to learn with. But I'm not so easy. But we do appreciate each one of them. Give him a hand, because, you know, God is good. And when he puts something together, it grows and gels and becomes what he wants. And so that's what we're here for, just to lift him up. And we want you to see Jesus. We want you to go out of here with Jesus. And we want you to touch somebody with Jesus. Because he's the only thing that's going to make a difference. Aren't you glad he loves us? We're winners because he loves us. And we're going to...
God on the mountain.
God on the mountain. You know, we may go through the trials and the test, but he's the God of every single level, from the valley to the mountain. He's God of all gods. He loves us. He created us to go through the valley so we can get a little stronger. But on that mountaintop, it's good up there. Sometimes we have to come back down. But it's rich down in that valley. Don't you love him? He's God on the mountain.
Life is easy when you're up on that mountain and you've got peace of mind like you've never known. But when things change and you're down in the valley, don't lose faith. For you're never alone. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go wrong, he'll make them right. And the God of the good times, he's still God in the bad times. The God of the day is still God of the night.
Don't you love him? Aren't you glad he's in control? He loves you. Tell somebody Jesus loves you.
When you're up on that mountain, oh, but talk comes easy. When life's at its best, but in the valley of trials and temptation, that's when faith is really put to the test. But the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go wrong, he'll make them right. I'm the God of the good times. He's still God in the bad times. The God of the day is still God of the night. Oh, the God of the day is still God of the night.
Aren't you glad he's God all the time? Give him praise and glory because he deserves it all. He loves us. He's never failed us. We failed him, but he just can't fail. Aren't you glad for that? We're going to have an instrumental right now, and they do a beautiful job, and a lot of you love this old song. If you know it, they don't mind you singing along with them. It's called The Old Rugged Cross. Can't get better than the old rugged cross, because without that old cross, we'd all be lost. But I'm so glad that Jesus was willing to go for us, aren't you? And I'm glad he's always there. And you know, we don't always understand what's going on down here. But he understands everything because he's got a perfect plan. We just get to be a part of it. And farther along, we'll know all about it. Amen. You know this old song? We want you to sing it with us. When we see Jesus coming in glory,
when he comes from his home in the sky. Then we shall meet him in that bright mansion, and we'll understand it all by and by. Farther along we'll know all about it, and farther cheer up, my brother, and live in the sunshine, 'cause we'll understand it all by and by. Yes, we'll understand it all by and by.
We will. But you know, when we get there, we're not even going to care, because we're going to have the whole answer right before us, and that was Jesus all along. He's never failed. He can't fail. And I'm glad I'm a part of a plan that can't fail, because I've sure been a part of them that did. But you know what? Jesus makes them, and they don't fall apart. And I'm glad he's going to finish the thing. And I just feel like traveling on. How many of you just want to keep
Amen.
On going?
Let's get her down.
Keep on pressing on, because that little old David lying in that hospital bed today, he could barely speak, and they were doing all kinds of things, and he's choking on his pills, and he looked at me, and he said, press on. And you know what? When somebody like that in that kind of shape can look at you and say, press on, we can't give up. We got to press on. This is called I Feel Like Traveling On. How many of you feel like traveling on? Get somebody by the hand, because that's where we're going. We're going up, saying it could be right now.
If you know it, sing along with us.
Come on, y'all.
My heavenly home is bright and fair, and I feel like traveling on. No pain nor death can traveling on. Yes, I feel like traveling on. I feel like traveling on. My heavenly home is bright and fair, and I feel like traveling on. Glittering towers, the sun outshines. I feel like traveling on. My heavenly mansion shall be mine, and I feel like traveling on. Come on, y'all, sing. Yes, I feel like traveling on. I feel like traveling on. My heavenly home is bright and fair, and I feel like traveling.
We're going to make it. How many of you believe that? It's going to be beyond what we can even imagine.